broadcasting from the depths of outer space.
Hello, I'm alive. I don't know what's going on.
By your command.
God damn you all to hell!
This is the Sci-Fi Podcast.
Coming live from the tomb of in Egypt, it's on from America. New York, is it?
New Jersey!
New York. And live from Portsmouth.
Oh.
Look, look.
Hello, 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 hello. How are you doing? Your lighting's better on your face than mine. I look a bit sort of pale and look like I need some sunshine or something. How are you guys doing?
And live from London is what? And we're
all coming
from
yourself.
Another dimension.
Yes.
Through the ages of time and space. And we're here again on a Wednesday.
On a Wednesday. Well, yes, it's nice to have you both in. Nice to see you. Last week we had a few problems with Tom's video. It froze after about 2 minutes into the actual show. So, but you all look fine this week. You're all moving about. And December 7th. No, I can't. I was going to pretend to freeze up, but it's not going to fool you. I know you can. I was going to mock about you. So, how are you both doing?
I'm splendid. It's a beautiful weather here in New Jersey.
Oh, it's rainy.
It's like summertime.
Oh, what's the name of this storm today, Martin? You know, in the UK now we name rainy days now. It's like storm.
I think you call it Hurricane Megan and Harry.
Yeah. Oh no. Well, that's a hurricane in its own right, isn't it? That's
Yeah.
Oh my God, that thing's.
Yeah. You can have them. We don't want them.
Yeah, you could keep them. They could stay there.
Keep them. Okay, but I've got more things to worry about than them too.
Hey Tom, have you got a spare room in your house?
Well, the prince can sleep, hang out in the basement. It's perfectly fine.
Well, I'll be sure to tell Harry and Meghan then, Tom, that you're prepared to put them up.
I am prepared to put them up. You can let them know.
Okay.
Actually, it's probably easier for me to tell them because they're here.
We don't want them back, mate.
I don't know if they can get back. I think Queen Mum took their passports or something.
Hey, they've caused quite a bit of devastation. I mean, I'm not bothered about it, but Piers Morgan, if you've heard of him, walks off Princess morning television.
Yeah, I saw that. That was
quite
funny.
In a big argument. Oh, no. He stormed off.
Apparently, he had a fight with the weatherman or something.
Bloody weatherman.
Well, like the old days of Wincy Willis, is it, eh, Martin? It's all, like I said, I think it's a bit overrated, a bit sort of...
So how's everybody's week been then?
Yeah,
how's
all right.
The vaccinations going? Tom, have you been vaccinated yet?
Oh, I got my first vax and then get
good
my second
man.
One in
good man.
Next
good.
Week. Two weeks.
Are you glowing green on the night? Has anything strange happened, like mutations?
I woke up in the middle of the night with my teeth chattering.
Oh!
That was the only problem I had. I didn't get any cool powers or anything like that. I can't see through
I did. I got a 4-foot penis. And when I have a shit, I fire lasers out of my eyes.
And the toilet explodes again.
It's worn off now.
It was only a short-term thing. So it's a bit like gamma rays, isn't it? It's like Dr. David Banner, isn't it? But it's Dr. David COVID or something.
I bet your eyes glowed green, didn't they, when you had yours? You know, like you were like Bruce Banner, you know, from that TV series.
I felt a bit shivery and a bit shaky, but like I said, it's got to be done. I mean, my next one, because we've got a bigger gap over here for our second booster.
Mine's April,
22nd of April.
America does everything bigger and worse, so mine's in 3 weeks. So.
Yeah, that's all right. Just get out of the way and then hopefully... Right, so let's go into the news of the week, because we've got a bit condensed now with this recording, so I want to talk to you about that.
Can I just say before, I watched last week's podcast, because obviously I couldn't make it, but... It's thank God we got past the island of Dr. Moreau. Thank God. Tom, I had to suffer that. Thank you very much. I had to suffer. I did watch documentaries.
I saw it,
about the chaos on that film set.
Yeah,
that's
almost good enough. You don't need to watch the movie.
I'm glad I saw it. Somebody.
Orgies and drugs. Bringing them back from airport.
I know. Somebody told me to watch the Burt Lancaster one from the 70s, I think it is. So apparently, there's a different version, which I've not seen. I'll give that a go at some point.
Michael and I decided last week that perhaps we should watch decent movies.
Yes.
As opposed to torturing ourselves with this stuff.
Yeah, but that's all part of the fun when we're torturing ourselves.
That's true.
So what about a mix? What about a mix where, like I said, I think I'm on the fence with both because it is really hard to motivate yourself to watch some of these films. But yeah, I mean, I think we're just, I mean, I haven't got, I haven't had a chance to do your one that you recommended this week, Martin, so I'm sorry about that. But yeah, we'll do it.
I'm off. If you go, I'm going. You know,
sorry, Martin. You know what? I felt so guilty when I did, when I because you weren't in the graphic from last week, and poor Martin wasn't there, and I felt really bad that I took him out of the graphic. I tend to put the people. Said
oh man!
What?
I felt sad about that too.
I felt really guilty, but I like to. What I do is I like to show the people who are actually on the show that we're doing. You say,
yeah.
So, but I don't matter
about me. I don't have any feelings. I've got no feelings.
It feels like when Stalin used to erase people from photographs.
Oh, stop it! Oh God!
It's not exactly the same, but it's almost exactly the same. I mean,
I'll tell you one thing. I did the graphic for WandaVision this week, and it was bloody hard to do. Because I had to do the image with the two characters, and then the edges of the graphic are like in the 50s and different color. So then I had to have an old astronaut suit on part of my body, and then I had to change. Oh, I love doing it.
It was beautiful, though. I got to tell you, it's beautiful. You guys want to jump into the news?
Let's go for it, Tom. Absolutely.
There's a lot to talk about.
Absolutely, Tom. Right, here we go. Here's the jingle.
Working. Solar Sci-Fi News.
All right, Tom, do you want to start off?
So from a news perspective, I've been watching For All Mankind again, and I'm finding it to be pretty good series this year.
Okay.
I don't know if you guys have seen it. It's on Apple Plus. It's definitely worth seeing.
I've not seen it, but I did. When you mentioned it before, it came up on my YouTube stream, clips of it, and I've been watching it. It's set in an alternative universe, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
Russia and America. Russia got to the moon first.
And that scene
with the Russian cosmonaut on the moon base when he turns the airlock off and that. It's incredible. But it's on Apple TV, though, isn't it?
So,
it's on Apple TV.
Tom, remind me, how many series has this new show been? Is it a new series or has it been...
You're in series two right now, so it's been on for 2 years, so there's a good 13 episodes to catch up on.
Wow.
Okay, I'll give it a go.
It's really compelling, and it gets very... It's also very much like a family drama, too, because it's about their astronauts, you know, down in Texas, wherever they are, and, you know, mission control and things like that, and they all, you know...
Sounds good,
It's got a little bit of the right stuff in it.
I mean, I'll try and give that a go, because there is a bit of a gap now, there's a bit of a void since we finished WandaVision last week, which we're going to talk about.
Honestly, I've only seen clips of this thing. It looks amazing, especially the technology development from the 60s right until like the 80s. I want to see this. I mean, if it magically appears on my screen one day, I'll be quite happy.
I did see this week, although it's not sci-fi, I saw Coming to America, the sequel.
Is that any good?
I thought it was all right. It's not a patch on the original, but it's 32 years difference. It was okay. I didn't love it. I didn't loathe it. It was all right. Tom, what did you think of it?
Yeah, I agree. It was okay. And unfortunately, when you're trying to do a sequel to a film like Coming to America, that's not good enough.
No, I agree with
that. It was very much like, it was great to revisit those characters.
Yeah.
But they just didn't spend enough. It wasn't even truly about anything.
It was hardly in America at all. It was only about 10 minutes. The whole film was in America. The rest of it was in whatever the...
Zamunda.
Yeah, that's it. Zamunda. So it should be called Coming to Zamunda or something. I don't know what
it... They should have called it Coming to Zamunda.
Yeah, that's it.
But it was very little Eddie Murphy in it. I was surprised. Not only very little America, which doesn't really matter, but I was like, it's about these other characters. And they're great, compelling, interesting... good actors, and they're personable, like, you know, the young guy and the woman he falls in love with. But if I want to see an Eddie Murphy movie, it's going to have a lot of Eddie Murphy in it. I will say the highlight of that film for me was Wesley Snipes.
I was about to say that he was the best thing in the whole film. He was so funny.
He was amazing.
Yes, he was. He was. I agree entirely. Yeah, I wish they could have done a bit more with him actually, and Eddie Murphy's two characters.
If I had to go back and be Eddie Murphy's screenwriter, I would say pull out the stuff about, you know, don't rerun the same story backwards, kind of like what you do. Do it with just about you, you know, make it.
And
they
did they did de-age Eddie Murphy at one point. They put him back in the 80s movie, and so yeah. I always find it fascinating when they de-age actors. Scene where he was back in the original film, which I thought was quite good. I like that.
Yeah, Eddie Murphy looks fantastic anyway.
Yeah, so he does. He looks very good.
I think they just gave him a different haircut. Like, they just let his hair grow out again. But that's all they needed to do. But
I could tell. If you looked at his face, you could tell they de-aged him a bit anyway. You could see it was... Okay. Yeah, there was definitely some de-aging in it. But.
So, there's another film. The reason why he's connected with Wesley Snipes, he made a movie last year called... Dolomite's My Name, which is about the actor who made up the character of Dolomite, which is like a 70s blaxploitation comic foil type scenario where he was sort of like inner city badass, but it was all for laughs.
Right.
And it's about basically the story of how he came to success, and it is a fantastic movie. Highly suggested, and Wesley Snipes is in that as well, and he has the same comic chops, which are completely unexpected. It's like when you see a high end action star doing comedy; it's always it's fantastic.
I've never seen Eddie Murphy much in science fiction. I know he was almost in Star Trek IV, apparently. There was something where he was going to be where they try and travel back to 1986 in The Voyage Home. Apparently, Eddie Murphy was going to be in the film. And then it didn't work out in the end, and that might have been very interesting. I don't know if you heard about that. It looks like Thomas.
Yeah, I did hear about that, and that would have been pretty cool. He was supposed to be in Star Trek IV. I think he would have, if any Star Trek he was going to be in, it would have been that one.
Yeah, because that is the most comedic of the original series films, anyway. Yeah. So I think.
Generally, a good movie.
It did do two sci-fi movies. Did one on the moon or something. I saw it years ago, and he did this weird one. About little people that live inside the body. It's like a spaceship.
Okay.
And they come to Earth. Yeah. I vaguely remember it. They both flopped badly. Right. I forgot. Yeah. They did a big one, spent hundreds of millions of dollars. He's an astronaut on the Moon City or something. And it sunk. I've seen it years ago. And then there was one where little people are inside your body controlling it. A weird movie. I forgot what it's called.
I'd have to look it up in the Internet Movie Database. That sounds definitely interesting.
He's had ups and downs with. I think the more money Eddie Murphy spends on a movie, the less well it does. But if he does a movie that's just him being funny and being talented, he does fantastic.
Yeah.
But wrapping him up in a big high concept thing is does not seem to be an advisable Hollywood prop.
For me, Eddie Murphy's era was the 80s, with obviously Coming to America, Trading Places, Beverly Hills Cop. They're some of my favourite comedy films in the 80s.
Trading Places is one of the greatest comedies ever made.
I see it most Christmases. I watch it. I love it.
Yeah, it's every year. I'm obsessed with that movie.
Absolutely. Yeah. The Dukes from Trading Places, a picture of them did appear in the new film, Coming to America. It was the Duke's nephew or something. There was a relative in it who was from the Dukes because they came to power again, because in the Coming to America, the first one, you got the money back. So,
definitely catch up. If you want to see vintage Eddie Murphy done recently, Dolomite Is My Name is a fantastic option.
Yeah, all right. I'll give it a go. I'm always up.
It's hilarious. I love true stories about creative types being a creative type, like the story behind the story, and this is good stuff. And it's a period piece. It's set in the 70s. It's hilarious. It's all for laughs.
Sounds good. I'll check it out.
Shall we jump into WandaVision?
Any other quick news before we go into our main subject?
Yeah, I've got some news. It's interesting.
Okay, what's that?
It's going to change the world. Exclusive Wrath of Khan director Nicholas Meyer.
Oh, I've got that in front of me. I'm just reading it. I was going to jump. You jumped ahead.
Yes, I got one in there.
He's pitched a new movie idea to Paramount for a new idea. So, that sounds interesting.
Trek fan sent me something today. Hello, Trek fan. Hope you're well, mate.
Hello, Trek fan. How you doing?
Galaxy Quest revival in the works.
Good. stuff.
Yeah, but they haven't got... Who was the guy that died in it that played the scientist? I mean, Galaxy Quest needs... What's the guy in it? The guy that was in...
Alan Rickman.
Yeah, Alan Rickman's Alan gone. Rickman, yeah. So, I mean... Can they do it without Alan Rickman? Because he was quite integral.
They can. I think they would have a, you know, part of it would be around him about the loss of him.
Yeah.
You know, okay. They'd have to acknowledge that. But it's got such a great cast. I think they could pull off. With,
yeah, maybe.
Yeah, they could pull off. It's got Sigourney Weaver and Sam Rockwell, and it's just it's got a wealth of talent in there.
Brilliant. Okay. Any other
guys? There's a hotel being built in 2026 in outer space.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. A private company. They're going to build a circular shaped space station, and it will hold 40 tourists. You can go up there and have an holiday.
Yeah, but you've got to get. It's still quite hard to get into space. I suppose it's getting easier to get into space, but I mean, the latest Starship landed and then exploded on the actual. Launch pad.
Yeah, but it was fantastic watching that. It looked like a rocket ship from Flash Gordon.
It looks like Thunderbird 3.
Yeah, it was incredible. There's a
shot of that thing landing I thought was fake. It looks like CGI, and it's literally just the angle on it was unbelievable. That's crazy. And to be honest, they really weren't too concerned about those landing safely. It was
it's all just getting information about the dimensions of the actual. So it looks bad in principle when you see it, but it's not. These are all tests, and these are all ways to avoid potential issues in the future. It's all sort of like accumulating information.
So the question I put to you both, you know, that is apparently on a website, he's wanting people to go to Mars. Are you both going to sign up?
No, because I don't like flying.
Go to Mars. I gotta say no. I would go to Mars, but I gotta tell you, all this talk about going to Mars, I think, is like deciding to skip university and go right into grad school. We have the moon right next to us, and
focus on that
we
first.
Haven't done anything on
no,
the moon?
No, I agree. There is so much to
go
on the moon.
We should go to the moon first.
Yeah, I think.
They are in 2024. They're going back out to the moon.
Artemis is going to the moon. I would go to the moon. The idea that you can come back in like 3 days is appealing to me.
I mean, to be stuck on Mars for 2,000 days or whatever till the next time. I don't eating tins of beans. I don't think I'll be into that really.
Well, it's only interesting. All right, guys, I think we better move on to our topic of the week, if that's all right with you, Martin, because we've got this limited recording time.
No, that's super duper.
That's some great news. Thank you very much. Let's go into the jingle one. This is going to be an interesting one. Here we go.
It's the Solar Sci-Fi Focus of the Week.
Right. WandaVision is finished. You two have seen it. I'm a hashtag Marvel virgin, as you know.
Half a virgin. Half.
Yeah, all right. I'm half cherry. Right. Let's ask, first of all, Martin, what did you think of it?
Absolutely spectacular. When they brought the White Vision into it as well, that was just so much from comics. And it was just spectacular. I was surprised that Agatha Harkness was the villain, because she is a goodie in the comics. But they've done it that way. It made a lot of sense. It was great. I love the connection to the MCU. Brilliant. And the final battle scene. I felt so sorry for what she had to sacrifice to.
Yeah.
You know, it was so... You just felt so bad. But it opened it up for Doctor Strange right at the end with the Darkhold. So okay. I was impressed.
All right, Tom, what do you think about it?
I loved it. And what I actually think is going on was that Wanda was the villain. I don't think there's necessarily a hero in this.
I heard that. Yeah, I've heard that she's still considered a villain, especially in what she did to those town people.
Doing awful things. Yeah. She eventually realized she was doing it, she didn't stop doing it. And until the very end, those, you know, the agents on the outside were dealing with a really insane, crazy problem that they couldn't see an end to. I mean, obviously that guy, what's his name, was doing some shady stuff, and he was clearly the villain.
Oh, the sword guy from Sword.
Yeah, the sword guy. But emotionally, he was the villain. But, you know, technically, he would have been the hero. I mean, obviously, they set him up and they had Darcy and Jimmy Woo out there kind of posing him because he was pretty much a giant jerk. But technically, you know, if there was a... I live in New Jersey, and if someone covered my town in like in red weird energy and was keeping everyone locked in here, you know, I would think the guy trying to get me out would be the good guy, not the crazy witch who's lost her mind is keeping everybody. But what's fascinating about the entire thing, I'll say two things about it. They managed to make her, even after all that, even after you knew all that, they made her, you loved the idea of her and understood her pain so much that you still rooted for her. And the way that it started, I have to say about Marvel that they've made so much money and they've got so much intellectual property and characters to choose from. They went with the weirdest, riskiest possible thing.
And this,
and there is no like, there's some like House of M type stuff related to the series, but there isn't like a comic book where it's like she re-envisions sitcoms, you know, that's made up for this. And that is a huge risky thing to do. And I often say like WandaVision could have been about a guy named Juan. His last name's Division, and he just does math problems, and it's a Marvel thing. You know, and they would have still made $1 billion off of it, because they could, you know, they made billions of dollars off of Guardians of the Galaxy, which is like literally a tier four set of characters. But this one was amazing, and the two actors have such unbelievably good chemistry.
They do. I agree entirely.
You know, and Paul Bettany, I want him to read stories to me as I'm trying to get
I've got Paul Bettany's very, very first acting job. There's a series in the UK called The Bill, which was shown a lot in the 80s. And he plays this guy. I've got it.
He was on The Bill.
He was on The Bill. He was in a basketball court with these kids. He was like a kid, sort of like a student, like a teacher trainer kind of thing. And he doesn't look that much. He obviously looks younger, but I really enjoy watching him because of seeing him in these big films. From my perspective, like I said, I'm quite new to this. This is the first Marvel TV series I've watched, but I am going through the Avengers films, and I'm going to watch. I've seen Guardians of the Galaxy. I'm watching the second one tomorrow because I know that the next Avengers features them. So I'm learning. I'm getting there.
Can we get a Michael bullet point? Just your basics, like your concepts of it. What are you?
My concepts are, I didn't expect this to be, this isn't what I thought a Marvel production would be like. It had a lot of philosophical ideas about the idea of being, and I like the idea that people in this town were almost, they're almost like brainwashed. And it was surreal because you didn't know from perspective when you watch it, what on earth is going on? Why are we in a sitcom? Why is it the 50s? Then why does it jump? And why is it that... And like, so like I said, from my perception, it was different because I've not seen all these films like you guys have seen. So to you two, it must have been even more unfamiliar. But I like the characterization. I thought Vision was a very interesting character. It reminded me of Data at the end that... you know, part of his essence was stored, even though he died in one of the films, and then that essence also went into the new Vision at the end. So I can see some Star Trek aspects with regard to artificial life having its intellectual or its intelligence transferred over and keep continuing. And I did like it. Like I said, I wish I could give more based on other Avengers and other Marvel productions, but I just thought it was solid. I thought the acting was great. I thought the characterizations were very good. Again, it's one of these new things like The Mandalorian where it's, for me, TV and film now is becoming so blurred. The way they make these things now are such a high standard that for me, it's no longer TV. It's not a TV, it's like a mini movie, just literally being shown at home. That's the way it's going, and this is becoming more and more like this.
I absolutely love it.
It's a very exciting time for Marvel fans like you guys are, and I'm learning it. I mean, I was going to ask you, have other Marvel shows been of this high standard, or is this the first time?
This is the first one.
That's what I was wondering, because there's a new one
next week.
Yeah, I heard there's a new thing coming up next week as well.
Winter Soldier and Falcon, but you're going to have to watch Captain America, Winter Soldier, Civil War.
I'll go through them all. I was going to say that, you know, for us as sci-fi fans and Marvel, it is so exciting. I mean, what they're doing with Star Wars now, and like I said, you watch a Star Wars, Mandalorian, it's not a TV show, it's a film, a short film at home. And this WandaVision was exactly the same. So, yeah, I think it's very exciting for us three. We're going to have a lot of stuff to watch and talk about in the future.
The series everybody's looking forward to is the Loki series that's coming
in
June.
Oh, it's going to be great.
Where he's the Time Variance Authority, where he's travelling alternative realities.
Oh, okay. I like that. Sliders or something.
Yeah, that's Loki, Thor's brother.
Very cool.
He gets arrested back. That Time Variance Authority, like the Gab, the timeline and alternative realities.
I love stuff like that.
So that's coming in June. I mean, it's a dream come true, but my friend said to me when he loved it, but he don't read a lot of comics, and he said he worries though that if you're not into, like, if you're new to it, you could get a bit confused, because, you know, like you said, Tom, about like the House of M, it was very much in there. Want it, the whole House of M thing, you know.
Yeah.
I think with some people are going to be absolutely confused.
What we have, though, what's good is that if you are excited to get on the bandwagon, you can.
Yep.
People are putting out like 10-minute videos to watch before you watch WandaVision, and you can just catch up there. Because once you pop into the high quality, interesting things going on, it's like it doesn't even matter, because they're doing a really good job telling a fun story. And just think about the actors they have in the upcoming Loki series. It's Tom Hiddleston and Owen Wilson. I mean, those guys are A-list movie stars that are in a TV series now. And there's no way on earth I'm missing that. That is going to be fantastic.
No, I can't wait for it. And the good news is that Chris Evans is coming back as Captain America. Is going to be the first one's going to be Hydra Captain.
Oh, really?
Going to be like the opposite of Captain America. Awesome. Captain like Hydra Cap.
That is going to be fantastic.
Yeah, so, I can't wait. This is dream come true for me, as always.
Yeah. So one more thing, one more tip for Michael. So if you haven't seen any, or you're looking to pick a couple of Marvel movies to watch, my personal favorite is two personal favorites, but my top one is Ragnarok. I love that movie.
Okay.
Ragnarok, it is so silly and funny, and Taika Waititi could basically make anything and I'd watch it. It is so great.
Well, the thing is, though, I mean, I think I know you two quite well, and I'm definitely on your wavelength with what a lot of stuff we've watched. So, you know, if you're both telling me to check these out, then I respect your opinions, and I will certainly give them a go, because in the end, you know, there's also a void with new stuff to watch in some ways, because a lot of stuff's being made and postponed because of COVID and stuff. So, yeah, all right, I'm up for that. If you tell me...
Can I just say, are you looking forward to the Zack Snyder Justice League next week?
Maybe. I mean, I always thought that those movies were a bit of a slog, whereas Marvel movies are fun and light, and even though they're pretty impactful and well-made, they're, you know, you don't need a nap and a therapy session afterwards. But DC, to me, has not hit the mark with many of the things that they've done. So I'm probably sure I'll watch it, but maybe not, you know, with the level of enthusiasm for this. But I think it's fascinating for a director to put out something like the Snyder Cut, because it's his vision that was more or less taken away from him, and it's the kind of alternate review thing. You know, the Justice League was a mess. I watched part of it, and I turned it off and on and watched it over like 5 days, because I just wasn't into it. And the tone was, you know, rapidly changing. You could tell when they switched out the directors. It stood out as
you can see that sometimes in certain productions, can't you? That it just doesn't quite work.
Yeah. So let me ask you guys a question about the WandaVision. Did you, when you were watching it, I mean, I felt almost like we were watching something in reverse. Like, you know, there was clearly a mystery here that was, you know, clear to be explained. When you were watching it, did you have any preconceived notions as to what was happening?
Martin, you ask first because you're more of an expert than I am. What did you think? I'll put you on the spot.
I thought it was like they had, there was some entity behind it, like Nightmare on Feaster. And that was the going thing on YouTube.
Yeah.
There was something that she, obviously, she's a chaos magic, no control of it. And I knew that she created this bubble through, you know, from like with the House of M thing, you know, and it was connected to that. But it, I didn't know where it was going to go, you know, the whole thing. And that's what I sort of found interesting. And the villain, there was no major super villain in it. Yeah. It was just Agatha Harkness, you know, just a witch. And yeah. I was expecting her. I thought she were in there to bring her back to reality, you know. But she wasn't. She were manipulating yeah. events herself. I like the thing with Monica Rambeau as well, because yeah, she's obviously going to be next Captain Marvel film.
I mean, I'm going to wrap up quite soon. We've got 6 minutes left of recording before we conk out. So let me say what I thought. I honestly thought the whole town that she was in, I thought it was all like a holodeck. I didn't think it was actually interacting with real people. The people were there, but they were sort of changed by her powers or whatever. So I thought the whole thing was a giant illusion. I mean, it was kind of more than that, because of course there was this hex thing. I just had quite a few surprises about the whole production. Like I said, from watching the first two or three episodes, and a big fan of sitcoms as well, and yeah, it wasn't what I thought Marvel would come up with. And I think that's one interesting aspect for me. But now I'm coming back and seeing the characters in the Avengers films the wrong way around, unfortunately. It's very interesting, like, because I've seen that now Wanda, when you first meet her, she's got this like European accent, and she's, when you watch her in the TV show, she's got an American accent. So I thought, so it's interesting. So I'm sort of seeing it, the Avengers in many ways, like a prequel. So it's strange like that, but it's just the way it's going. But I'm really glad I saw it. I'm really glad that I checked it out.
Yeah, I'm glad I saw it too. And I'm actually kind of glad there wasn't a big bad behind it all, like, you know, showing somebody in the last 5 minutes of being responsible.
I thought there'd be some big character in the last 2 minutes. It had two endings, but I didn't know the character, the green character at the end. I didn't know who that character was.
The Doctor Strange connections there when the Sorcerer Supreme.
Yeah, I knew that I was going to be missing out on stuff like that. Yeah. That's my unfortunately.
She was the book at the end, what she was reading, a little clip at the end. That's the Darkhold. That's where he's going to come into it.
Okay.
The Darkhold, it's the big evil book of magic in the Marvel Universe.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. I think my favorite episode. Did you guys have a favorite episode, Michael?
I don't know. I think when it was at near the end, it was more revealed as to what was going on with the witch character. Episode 7, I think it was, when she revealed as the big baddie in the background. I thought that was interesting.
Maybe it was that song was an ass knocker. That was the best song ever when they... Yeah. It was like the Munsters. Yeah.
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
God, that was so...
I mean, in this recording, in the background, I've got lots of theme tunes from sitcoms in the background with the cheesy laughter track, so you'll hear that when you come back. But I love the way that they redid the old sitcoms and mixed it into, like, WandaVision is making their own sitcom. You know, we had the rip-off of Family Ties, we had the one of a bit like The Office. I loved all that as a fan of situation comedy. So, yeah, but I liked the whole thing. It's hard to be specific about what point I liked it.
I think I enjoyed myself the most in the Halloween episode.
Yes, that was a good one. That was a very fun one.
I think I just liked it. I think there was a lot going on, you know, that silly Sokovian fortune teller costume, you know, and Elizabeth Olsen just so damn charming that she pulls that stuff off. And they had like the original old Vision, like they're dressed as their old like 1970s.
Yeah.
That was hilarious, and I just thought it was really neat, and it kind of brought them, you know, it was the episode where Vision was trying to escape and he couldn't get out, and I love that episode.
Well, we have to wrap up now because we've just literally got 2 minutes of recording left on the on this thing. But thank you guys for reviewing that. Sorry, I haven't got time for a challenge, but we'll definitely do that. So we'll have to work out a different way of.
We'll do that next week.
Yeah, we haven't got the time this time, but thank you. Are you two guys interested in us reviewing Star Trek Picard next week? What do you think?
Yeah,
I want to give that a review. Yeah. I mean, because we've never featured it properly. And it might be. I would like to hear Tom's opinion as well. So, are you both free next week for the show?
Yep, I'm sorry. I'm going to make a confession. I'm going to make a confession. I bought it on Blu-ray and Sainsbury's. I shouldn't have done it. I did it. I don't know why. I know. I'm going to shoot myself.
No. I think that, you know, as we're Star Trek fans. I mean, like you said, and the thing is, you watch something for a second time when, you know, you build up sort of hopes as to how it's going to go, and sometimes it doesn't quite meet them.
Yeah.
It might be preferable to watch it on the second time round. When I saw your review of the Series 8 of Doctor Who, John Pertwee, I've seen you've got the box set. Looks great.
It came this morning.
Yeah, I know. I saw your YouTube, so I'm sure you enjoy that. Listen, guys, thank you very much. We'll be back next week with Star Trek Picard, and that'd be interesting to see that. I might try and watch the whole series again so I can have a better opinion for next week. So we'll finish with, this is a funny song. It's done on YouTube. It's a version of, what was it? Agatha All Along, All Night, All Along, I think it is.
Agatha All Along.
Yeah, something like that. I'm going to try and put that on. But if it plays up...
Let's dance to it.
Actually, it's a remix by another band called The Hound and the Fox. So that should play all right.
Right.
Thank you, guys. We'll catch you next week on the Solar One
Live Long and Sci-Fi Prosper
podcast. Catch you later.
Killed Sparky too.